nigh brief. For Mazzini, a nationality means a race, a fixed array of behavior like a breed of dog or a species of animal. He's not thinking of a national community united by a literate language and a classical culture to which any person can become assimilated through a political choice. For Mazzini, race is unchangeable. Race is destiny. It's a matter of blood and soil. Cats fight dogs, French fight Germans, Germans fight Poles, and so on through all eternity. These hatreds are the main datum of sensory perception. Each of Mazzini's organizations demands immediate national liberation for its own ethnic group on the basis of aggressive chauvinism and expansionism. Mazzini's warhorse is the territorial imperative. They're all obsessed with borders, territory. Each one finds a way to sabotage dirigistic economic development. Each one is eager to submerge and repress the other national groupings in the pursuit of its own mystical destiny. This is Mazzini's racist gospel of universal ethnic cleansing. Now, we've seen some Italian cages. We also have the Hungarian theme park in the zoo. Our principal specimen here is Louis Kossuth, a leader of the Hungarian Revolution of 1848-1849. Kossuth told the British he was for free trade. He wanted equal status for Hungarians in the Austrian Empire, equal with the Austrians. But within the Hungarian part of the Habsburg Empire, there were other groups, Poles, Ukrainians, Germans, Serbs, Romanians, Croatians, and others. Would they receive political and linguistic autonomy? Kossuth's answer was to ban all official use of Slavic and Romanian languages in favor of Hungarian. Kossuth was therefore on a course for bloody collision with the Illyrian movement for Greater Croatia and with the military forces of the Croatian leader Jelacic. There was also conflict with Serbs. Mazzini had promised the same territory to Hungary, to the Croatians, and to his Serbian South Slav entity. And then there was the question of Transylvania, claimed by the Hungarians, but also by the young Romania of Dimitrie Golescu, another Mazzini agent. Young Romania's program was to restore the kingdom of Dacia, that is, as it had existed before the Roman Emperor Trajan. So young Hungary and young Romania were pre-programmed to fight to the death over Transylvania, which they did last year. Because of the ceaseless strife of Hungarians, Croatians, Hungarians, Serbians, Romanians, it proved possible for the Habsburgs to save their police state with the help of a Russian army. So we see the ethnic theme houses of the zoo sally forth to fight not just the Habsburgs and the Romanovs, but most of all, each other. And we will find the same thing in viewing the Russian and Polish pavilions. The young Poland of Lillewell and Wurzel demands the recreation of the Polish state and the rollback of the partitions of Poland. But they go much further, claiming borders from the Baltic to the shores of the Black Sea, the Jagiellonian borders. This includes an explicit denial that any Ukrainian nation exists. In the orbit of young Poland is the poet Adam Mickiewicz, a close friend of Mazzini's, who was with him last year during the Roman Republic. Mickiewicz argues that Poland is special because it has suffered more than any other nation. Poland is the Christ among nations. Mickiewicz dreams of uniting all of the West and South Slavs against the tyrant of the North, the barbarians of the North. And by that he means Russia, the main target. Young Poland's program also foreshadows an obvious conflict with young Germany over Silesia. Young Russia means the anarchist Mikhail Bakunin and the aristocratic ideologue Alexander Herzen. Herzen is an agent of Baron James Rothschild of Paris. Right after the Crimean War, Herzen will start publishing the Polar Star and the Bell, leak sheets for British secret intelligence that will build up their readership by divulging state secrets. Now, Herzen's obvious target is Tsar Alexander II, the ally of Lincoln. Herzen prints the ravings of Bakunin, who preaches pan-Slavism, the idea that Russia will take over all the other Slavic nations. Out of an ocean of blood and fire, there will rise in Moscow, high in the sky, the star of the revolution to become the guide of liberated mankind. Vintage Bakunin, vintage Third Rome. If Mazzini relies on the stiletto, For Bakunin, it's the peasant's axe that will bring down the German regime, as he calls it, in St. Petersburg. So Herzen's role is to sabotage Alexander II and his policy of real anti-British reform in Russia, to block capitalist development. He preaches reliance on the aboriginal Slavic village, the Mir, communal ownership of land, plus the ancient Slavic workshop, the Artel. Now, the Mir will never build the Trans-Siberian Railway. Herzen is sometimes called a westernizer, but he is totally hostile to Western civilization. He writes of the need of a new Attila, perhaps Russian, perhaps American, perhaps both, to tear down the old Europe. In the moment when the British will seem so close to winning everything, Herzen will support Palmerston's Polish insurrection of 1863, and he'll lose most of his readers. Once the American Civil War is over, the British will have little use for Herzen. By then, London will be betting on the nihilist terrorists of the Narodnaya Volnya, who will finally kill Alexander II. And London will use the Russian legal Marxists. But today we can see the conflicts between young Poland and young Russia, the national chauvinist operations that are laying the roots for the slaughter of World War I. Now, let us view the cages in the American theme park in Mazzini's Human Zoo. Young America. This name was popularized in 1845 by Edwin de Leon, the son of a Scottish Rite Jewish slave trading family of Charleston, South Carolina. Edwin de Leon will later be one of the leaders of the Confederate espionage service in Europe. Young America's leader is George Sanders, the future editor of the Democratic Review. Young America's program of Manifest Destiny is a slave empire in Mexico and the Caribbean. In the 1852 election, Young America will be backing the dark horse Democrat, Franklin Pierce, against the patriotic Winfield Scott. Scott's Whig Party will be destroyed. Young America operatives will receive important diplomatic posts in Europe, and there they will support Mazzini and his gang. Mazzini's American contacts are either proto-Confederates or strict abolitionists, like William Lloyd Garrison. During the American Civil War, Mazzini will favor both the abolition of slavery and the destruction of the Union through secessionism, which is the London line. This subversion will be showcased during the famous tour of Kossuth in the United States, which will happen next year and the year after. Kossuth is going to be accompanied by Mazzini's money bags, the Tuscan Freemason Adriano Lemmi. And on the eve of the Crimean War, with Palmerston doing everything to isolate Russia, Kossuth's line is that the tree of evil and despotism in Europe is, you guessed it, Russia. Kossuth will try to blame even the problems of Italy on Russia. Despite Kossuth's efforts, the United States will emerge as the only power friendly to Russia during the Crimean conflict. Kossuth will call for the United States to join with Russia, with England and France in a war against Russia, which is Lord Palmerston's dream scenario. Kossuth will even refuse to call for the abolition of slavery, and he'll get on very well with the slaveholders since he's talking about a U.S. takeover of Cuba, which meshes perfectly with the secessionist program. So Mazzini is the zookeeper for all of these theme parks, but there are other zookeepers and still more theme parks in the human multicultural zoo. The custodians are Palmerston's other two stooges, David Urquhart and Napoleon III. Now there is also a theme park for the British lower orders. The keeper here is the strange and eccentric Scot, David Urquhart, the most aristocratic of Palmerston's stooges. Urquhart was chosen for his work directly by Jeremy Bentham, who praised our David in his letters. Urquhart took part in Lord Byron's Greek Revolution, but he found that he liked Turks better after all. He got a post in the British Empire in Constantinople and went native, becoming an Ottoman Pasha in his lifestyle. His positive contribution to civilization was his popularization of the Turkish bath. But He also kept a harem much of the time. Urquhart was also of the opinion that late Ottoman feudalism was a model of what civilization ought to be. Urquhart became convinced that all evil in the world had a single root, Russia, the machinations of the court of St. Petersburg. That's a very convenient view for Lord Palmerston's Britain, which is always on the verge of war or at war with Russia. For Urquhart, the unification of Italy is a Russian plot. He once met Mazzini and concluded after 10 minutes that Mazzini is a Russian agent. That stooge on stooge violence again. Now, this Russophobe thinks that the problems of Great Britain are only that Palmerston is a Russian agent and that Palmerston was recruited by one of his many, many mistresses, the Russian Countess Lieven. During the years of Chartist agitation, Urquhart bought up working class leaders and drilled them in the litany that all the problems of the English working man come from Russia via Lord Palmerston. To these workers, Urquhart teaches something that he calls dialectics. Urquhart will be a member of Parliament and controls a weekly newspaper, the Free Press. Now, of course, Palmerston understands that his subversive methods will always generate opposition from the Tory gentry and the Colonel Blimp crowd and the straight-laced crowd. So he has taken the precaution of institutionalizing the opposition under his own control with a raving megalomaniac leader to discredit it. Urquhart's demonization of Russia foreshadows something that will be called McCarthyism about a century from now. Urquhart's remedy is to go back to the simplicity of character, and merry England in the sense of retrogression to bucolic medieval myth. Quote, the people of England were better clothed and fed when there was no commerce and when there were no factories. Unquote. That is vintage Urquhart. Now, does this talk of pre-capitalist economic formations strike a familiar chord? Does anybody smell a big, fat, commie rat? How interesting that Urquhart should be the controller of British agent Karl Marx, who earns his keep as a writer for Urquhart's paper. David Urquhart is the founder of modern communism. It is Urquhart who will prescribe the plan for Das Kapital. Marx is a professed admirer of Urquhart. He acknowledges Urquhart's influence more than that of any living person. Marx will even compose a life of Lord Palmerston based on Urquhart's wild obsession that old Pam is a British agent, is a Russian agent of influence. This says enough about Marx's acumen as a political analyst. Marx and Urquhart agree that there is no real absolute profit in capitalism and that technological progress causes a falling rate of profit. Another of Urquhart's operatives is a certain Lothar Bücher, confidant of the German labor leader Lassalle, later secretary to the Iron Chancellor, Otto von Bismarck himself. After Gettysburg, Urquhart will move to France and try to open a theme park for right-wing Catholics. He will try to meet Pius IX and will join Cardinal Newman's Oxford movement at the First Vatican Council in 1870. Our third stooge. The current president and soon to be emperor of France, Napoleon III. Napoleon le Petit. As we have seen, he started off as a carbonaro and terrorist in contact with Mazzini. In 1836, Napoleon tried to parlay his famous name into a successful putsch. He failed and was exiled to America. Then Napoleon was given a private study at the new British Museum reading room and got to know Lord Palmerston. He began work on his book, Les Idées Napoléoniques. The main idea was that the original Napoleon was not wrong to be an imperialist, but only erred in trying to expand his empire at the expense of Great Britain. There's plenty of room for a French empire as a junior partner to the British. The preferred form of government would be democratic Caesarism with frequent plebiscites. Now, in 1848, Napoleon was working for the British as a special constable, a riot cop, to put down an expected Chartist revolution reported by Urquhart. There, Napoleon III, when he got to France, used his name to become president. Then he organized a coup d'etat to become emperor. Palmerston quickly endorsed the coup, but that caused hysteria on the part of the Victoria and Albert Palace clique. Palmerston was forced out, but he was soon back, stronger than ever. After hundreds of years of warfare, France at last had been broken, placed under a more or less dependable British puppet regime. The Western powers, the Anglo-French, were born. Napoleon III gave Palmerston one indispensable ingredient for his imperial strategy, a powerful land army. Soon an open Anglo-French entente was in full swing. When Victoria came to Paris, it was the first such visit by an English sovereign since Henry VI had been crowned King of France in Notre Dame in 1431. When Napoleon joined Palmerston in attacking Russia in the Crimea, it was the first war in 400 years to see France and England on the same side. Now, Napoleon III is Palmerston's strategic catamite, usually with about as much will of his own as an inflatable sex doll. We can think of him as a blow-up British agent. After the Crimea, Palmerston will need a land army against Austria and northern Italy. Napoleon, egged on by Cavour, who knows how to play the interstices, will oblige in 1859 with the Great Battle of Solferino, the same with Maximilian's Mexican adventure. During the American Civil War, Napoleon's pro-Confederate stance will be even more aggressive than Palmerston's own. In 1870, Bismarck will defeat Napoleon and send him back to exile in England. Here, Napoleon will plan a comeback, but he will figure that he has to be seen as a man on horseback. Problem is, he has a bladder ailment. The bladder operation designed to make him a man on horseback again will kill him. Napoleon III calls himself a socialist. He will style the latter phase of his regime the liberal empire. That means France as a theme park in the British Zoo. In 1860, Napoleon will sign a free trade treaty with the British. And on the way, he'll pick up a junior partner colonial empire in Senegal, and he will seize Indochina in 1862, something that will set the stage for a certain war in Vietnam about a century later. Under Napoleon, France will build the Suez Canal and lose it to the British. Napoleon III will furnish the prototype for the fascist dictators of the 20th century. After his defeat, he will bequeath to France a party of proto-fascist colonialists and revanchists beating the drum for Alsace-Lorraine, which Napoleon will lose. These revanchists will turn up in Vichy, the Fourth Republic, and the French Socialist Party of today. And so it will come to pass that Lord Palmerston will attempt to rule the world through the agency of a troika of stooges, each one of them the warden of some pavilion in a human zoo. The reason why must now be confronted. The British Empire exists in the mind of its victims. This is the empire of the senses, the empire of sense certainty, the empire of empiricism. It is the empire of British philosophical radicalism, of utilitarianism, of hedonistic calculus, existentialism, and pragmatism. Why are the British imperialists called the Venetian Party? Well, for one thing, they call themselves the Venetian Party. The future Prime Minister, Benjamin Disraeli, will write in his novel, Coningsby, that the Whig aristocrats of 1688 wanted to establish in England a high aristocratic republic on the model of Venice, making kings into doges with a Venetian constitution. During the years after the Council of Florence in 1439, the Venetian enemies of Nicholas of Cusa plotted to wage war on the Italian High Renaissance and Cusa's ecumenical project. To combat Cusa's Renaissance Platonism, the Venetians of the Rialto and Padova turned to a new-look Aristotelianism, featuring Aristotle's characteristic outlook, shorn of its medieval and Averroistic outgrowths. This was expressed in the work of Pomponazzi, contadini. During the War of the League of Cambrai, an alliance of virtually every power in Europe threatened to wipe out the Venetian oligarchy. The Venetians knew that France or Spain could crush them like so many flies. The Venetians responded by launching the Protestant Reformation with three proto-stooges, or ur-stooges, Luther, Calvin, Henry VIII. At the same time, Contadini and his Jesuits made Aristotle a central component of the Catholic Counter-Reformation and the Council of Trent, and put Dante and Piccolomini on the index of prohibited books. The result was a century and a half of wars of religion, a little dark age culminating in the great crisis of the 17th century. Venice was a cancer, consciously planning its own metastasis. From their lagoon, the Venetians chose a swamp and an island facing the North Atlantic, Holland and the British Isles. Here, the Giovanni party would relocate their family fortunes, their fondi, and their characteristic epistemology. France was colonized too, but the main bets were placed further north. First, Contadini's relative and neighbor, Francesco Zorzi, was sent to serve as a sex advisor to Henry VIII, whose raging libido would be the key to Venetian hopes. Zorzi brought much with him in his baggage. The Venetian party in England grew under the early Stuarts as Bacon and his wife, Thomas Hobbes, imported the neo-Aristotelianism of Fra Paolo Sarpi, the great Venetian game master of the early 1600s. Now, when James and Charles disappointed the Venetians in that 30 Years' War, Cromwell, Milton, and a menagerie of sectarians were brought to power in an all-Protestant civil war and commonwealth. This was the time of the Irish genocide, the foundation of the overseas empire in Jamaica. After the depravity of the Restoration, the glorious revolution of 1688 gave birth to the most perfect imitation of the Venetian oligarchical system that the world has ever seen. The great Whig and Tory aristocrats set as their goal a new all-encompassing Roman Empire with its center in London. After the defeat of Leibniz's attempt to save England, Great Britain set off on the path of empire with a new Hanoverian Guelph dynasty. It was in the War of the Spanish Succession, 1702 to 1713. This was the first war fought on a world scale and the last gasp for colonial rivals Spain and Holland. The Peace of Utrecht left the British supreme on the oceans. Louis XIV and Colbert were defeated by divide-and-conquer Venetian politics, and British cash was used to hire Brandenburg and Savoy to fight the French. By winning the coveted asiento, the monopoly on slave commerce with Spanish America, the British became the biggest slave drivers in the world. The wealth of Bristol and Liverpool would be built on slaves. After some decades of hellfire clubs, there came the War of the Austrian Succession, followed by the Seven Years' War. This was the end of France as a naval power and a worldwide rival for the British. William Pitt, Earl of Chatham, subsidized Frederick the Great of Prussia to win an empire on the plains of Germany. The British took Louisbourg, Quebec, drove the French out of Canada, became paramount in India. And at this point, like their successors in 1989, they were convinced that they could run wild, violating the laws of nature with no penalty, for nothing could now stand against them. But in loading their American colonies with their prohibitions of settlement and manufacture, their Quebec Act, Stamp Act, Townsend Act, intolerable acts, they set the stage for the American Revolution. In these years, William Petty, Earl of Shelburne and Marquis of Lansdowne, gathered a stable of ideologues and operatives, his stooges. These were Jeremy Bentham, Adam Smith, Edward Gibbon, founders of British philosophical radicalism, the most primitive form of Aristotle ever devised. There also came a Siamese twin called free trade. Shelburne was defeated by Hamilton, Franklin, and Washington, but he did succeed in destroying and destabilizing much of France. By now, British policy was in the hands of Shelburne's student and protege, William Pitt the Younger. After letting the horrors of Bentham's agents brew up for 3 years, Pitt was able to unite the continental powers against France in the first, second, and third coalitions. Napoleon shattered these coalitions, but his final defeat was the work of Scharnhorst, Gneisenau, and the Prussian reformers, but the beneficiaries were the British. At the Congress of Vienna in 1815, the British were clearly the dominant force, but still obliged to deal with Metternich, Russia, and Prussia. But under the regimes of Castlereagh and Canning, the stupidity, greed, and incompetence of Metternich and company made possible the revolutions of 1820, 1825, and 1830. By 1830, Lord Palmerston was ready to take control of the Foreign Office and begin his direct march to undisputed world domination. Metternich was still sitting on the lid of the boiling European cauldron, but Lord Palmerston and his three stooges were stoking the flames underneath. Now, there was a time when the center of oligarchy, usury, and geopolitics in the world was Venice, a group of islands in a lagoon at the top of the Adriatic. In the 16th century, in the wake of the League of Cambrai, Venice was that cancer, planning its own metastasis. These were the years during which a patrician party known as the Giovani, the youngsters, began meeting in a salon called Ridotto Morosini. It is here that the future course of England and Britain was charted.